Welcome to Biomicrobics 2022 webinar training events. This is Amr Zaki. I will be your moderator today. Dr. Kevin Sherman will be presenting today, Optimizing Gravity Grease Interceptor Performance. Dr. Sherman is the Director of Engineering and Regulatory Affairs at SeptiTech, one of Biomicrobics subsidiary divisions located in Maine. Dr. Sherman has a PhD in oceanography and is a registered professional engineer in 17 states. He has intensive experience in decentralized wastewater treatment projects, as well as states and counties on-site wastewater regulatory affairs. This is a 50 to a 55 minute presentation, followed by a 5 to 10 minute Q&A session. Please let us know where you are watching us from, and feel free to ask questions at any time, and we will try to answer them either during the presentation or during the Q&A session. Dr. Sherman, the screen is all yours now.
Okay, I'll go ahead and share it.
Yes, please.
Okay, now. Okay, you see my first slide there?
Yes, we do.
Okay. So I'll just go ahead and begin. You can go ahead and put questions in the chat whenever you come upon them. If it's something that I think I'm going to answer in a subsequent slide, I'll wait on answering something that is like a critical misunderstanding. I want to correct it right away and get you on the right path to understanding this topic. I'll do that as well. So the first irony of the presentation is that the term grease interceptor is commonly used. Installers know what the term means, and I will use the term throughout this presentation, but there's actually blessed little grease in a grease interceptor. And I'll go on and explain that right now. So the material that is in a grease interceptor is actually fats, oils, and grease. And grease is the least of those three categories. So one category are fats. Fats are of animal origin. They are solid at room temperature. That's what 68 degrees Fahrenheit means. Oils are similar to fats, but they are of plant origin, and they are liquid at that same temperature. Grease, in its exact terminology, is a man-made substance. It can be toxic. Whenever we take a sample in the field for fog, we always put it inside an amber glass jar because the fog concentration is sensitive to sunlight. We mix it in the laboratory with a known volume of hexane. And hexane isn't a suspended carcinogen, it's a known carcinogen. So this is not something that people outside of a high-level secure laboratory should be doing. The material is mixed with hexane and then put into a separatory funnel. It doesn't quite show here, but there is a there's a stopper in the top of this, and it's very important. This stopcock is placed in the off position so that entire
Kevin.
Yes.
I think we don't see the slides.
You don't see this slide?
Flipping. We just see the front page.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, let me start over again. Let me start with slideshow.
Yes, now.
From beginning. Okay, from this slide. Is this the slide I'm talking to you about?
Yeah, this is the, okay. The second slide.
Okay, so this is slide number two.
But it's not in presentation mode. It's just like we can see the side of the slides and the number of the slide. We can't see
wow.
it. And yeah.
What a weird thing. Okay. Let me stop sharing. I want to get this right, and then I'll come get it again. And I'll come to, let's see. So you were on this one. I'm gonna share with this one. Tell me what you see. Okay, I have to hit share. What do you see now?
Yes, that's
just
perfect.
One slide, right?
Correct.
And that's a separatory funnel over to the left. And there is a stopper in it that fits in securely on top of it. And basically what you do in the laboratory is you make a little Italian dressing where the hexane is the lighter material. It takes all of the fog, dissolves it in there, and then this lower part of the funnel is just water. So you open up the stopcock and let the water come out. And then when you only have the hexane, then you put a pre-weighed container inside the fume hood, and then just gently let the material that is in this upper layer fall into that pre-weighed container. And then in the fume hood, the hexane evaporates, and we record the milligrams of weight increase per liter of sample, and we come up with fats, oils, and grease, the fog. Okay, so I'll just go down from here. Let's see. Do you see a new slide now?
Yes.
Okay. So fog is a measure of the floatable substances in wastewater. And the fats and the oils have a similarity to them, but the grease is actually a man-made, construct and spoiler alert, baby oil isn't made from babies. Baby oil is mineral oil. It's the first oil to come off of petroleum in the distillation process. So it's a very lightweight oil, and we call that baby oil. So those are greases, but we call it a grease interceptor. We also call bacon leavings, we call that grease too, sometimes too. We call hamburger grease. So it's that kind of thing. When we call it a grease interceptor, we're using the term very loosely and not scientifically. So what we're trying to achieve in a gravity grease interceptor is take water that have high levels of fats, oils, and grease. They'll also have some food solids with them as well, and effectively retain as much of both of those as possible. And if it's working properly, you're going to release a treatable wastewater to the next downstream component of the system. And that component could be a on-site or decentralized system, but it could just as well be going to a lift station on Restaurant Row in a major city. And this drawing, this photograph over here to the right just shows one of many ways that individuals can basically abuse their system. So all of these solids do not go down the drain. They get removed and put into the solid waste, just leaving this somewhat emulsified grease and water mixture to be treated by the grease interceptors. So engineers talk about something called a design concept. So if we were talking about like a pair of glasses, those glasses would have a design concept that would be improving vision, protecting vision, et cetera. And if they were sunglasses, that might add things such as protecting the eyes from bright light and being a fashion statement. So there are all sorts of design concepts that go with any particular, system or pieces, parts. So the gravity grease interceptor has to accept this grease-laden liquid from a food service establishment and hold and let that liquid cool over time, because in that cooling process, lighter than water fraction rises to the top to form an upper layer, and solids settle to the bottom of the tank in a sludge layer. And this flotation and solid settling has to occur under calm conditions. Calm doesn't mean that the water is absolutely still. It just means that it is in a, there's no turbidity. There's no overturn of the contents. So it allows a cooled, clarified liquid to exit the interceptor or interceptors, if it takes multiple, by hydraulic displacement. So hydraulic displacement means if 1 gallon comes in, the water level rises and 1 gallon exits. And because the volume of an interceptor is fairly large, it's not 1 gallon in, 1 gallon per minute in, 1 gallon per minute out. It takes a lot longer for the effluent to flow out of the tank than it takes for it to go in. But if it's laminar flow, you won't get any turbidity or shaking up of the contents of the tank. So that's the concept that we're trying to think about. So the other thing to talk about is that there's more than one type of gravity grease interceptor. More than one type of grease interceptor. The one that's shown in the first photograph here is a gravity grease interceptor. That's a mid-seam tank, and the lower portion is already in the excavation, and they're putting the larger upper portion on top of it and fitting it right into a slot there. So it's kind of a very particular process to get it just right. But there's also things called hydromechanical grease interceptors. And these are more of the grease traps that are found in the building within the food service establishment, possibly in the floor, possibly under the working floor, where using hydromechanical processes, you're able to get the grease and put it into out of suspension and be able to collect that grease and use it more quickly and not have to wait for it to be spend a lot of time inside of a gravity grease interceptor. So these would be quicker. You know, this would be possibly emptied at least once a day, maybe a couple of times in a day. And there's also an automatic grease interceptor that uses sort of a squeegee effect and a rotating drum to get the yellow grease, which is the coming out of a grease trap, and putting it aside. And then the brown grease is what winds up in a gravity grease interceptor. That's still useful, but it's not nearly as profitable as yellow grease. And so, ladies, if you'll just put your hands over your ears for a second, a good use of yellow grease is cosmetics. It goes into lipstick, other types of things. It's actually yellow grease that goes into that. So sorry if you heard that. So the three keys to getting a gravity grease interceptor to perform, I call them the three T's because they all begin with the letter T. The first is time. And so how much time you give that the contents to cool and settle is a function of the total capacity of the tank and the flow path that it uses. So we can add baffles, compartments, filters to that tank to prevent short circuiting. And I am a firm believer that commercial grade filtration is very much a positive in the use of gravity grease interceptors. The second T is temperature, because we do have to cool this. The water coming out of a commercial dishwasher could be as high as 170 degrees Fahrenheit. And so that hot of a water is actually scalding to the human skin. And dishwashers used to be like home dishwashers that you just put them in, turn them on, let them run for a couple hours. Modern restaurants don't have time for that. What they do is they load all of their dishware, all of their silverware, et cetera, into a dishwasher, it looks more like a fume hood than it does a dishwasher. And when it's all full, when they lower the front, and when it snaps in on the bottom, then this really hot liquid gets all over the place, along with any kind of soap or emulsifier they're using. And in 5 to 10 minutes, they have completed a cycle, and they can lift that up. The steam comes pouring out of it. They actually have to wear gloves because the plates will be so hot after this. They touch them with their hands, or they'll break them. They'll drop them because it's just too hot. And then that's the kind of water that we're dealing with, beginning with. And so we have to give it enough time for cooling to occur. And the third T is turbulence. And we really don't want any inside of a gravity grease interceptor. We want things to settle based on its specific gravity. So the fats, oils, and grease all have a specific gravity less than water's one, and they rise, and then solids go to the bottom of that tank, and both have to be removed periodically. So let's talk in depth more about temperature. So a commercial dishwasher will discharge scalding water. If you can't deal with that, if you're having problems with an existing system working, one of the things you could do is switch to a chemical sanitizer, and that allows water, lowering the water temperature of the hot water heater down to 130 degrees. Well, it's still plenty hot, but it's really important because fats, the part of fats, oils, and grease that actually are solid at room temperature, they begin to solidify at a higher temperature than that, usually around 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So you only have 30 degrees to be able to cool it, to get it to the point where at least some of the fats begin to solidify. Okay, so I just covered that. Some people have used airlines to strip temperature out of a grease interceptor, but if you do that, you're gonna make it very turbulent, and you're gonna basically thwart the original concept of the grease interceptor. So now let's talk about various lipids. These lipids include fats and oils, and they have a lot in common, but there's a lot of detail in here as well. And I think it was Mark Twain who once wrote, "All generalizations are false, including this one." And this is a generalization that is pretty false in its own way too, because it makes it sound like all of the fat from a pig will melt at 84 degrees. Well, every fat is a different fatty acid in different combinations, and they average about that, but some do it sooner, some do it lower. Also, it's different about the species of animal and plant. So, you know, here, pigs at 84, sheep's at 104, olive oil's at 43. You probably haven't seen olive oil in solid form unless you keep it in the refrigerator. Butter, corn-fed cattle, 90 degrees. So all of these have different melting points, but it's not as cut and dried as just that table shows you. And then melting points are different from lipids taken from different parts of an animal. So in a pig, we have basically the fat in the area around the back that is, that's what Canadians call back bacon. We call it Canadian bacon, but it's from the back. But around the kidneys, there's another type. It's called leaf lard, and it is a different type of lipid. It has a different melting point, only because it's taken from a different part of the animal. Other interesting issues is that melting points are different based on the animal's diet. We have cattle corn-fed at 90 degrees. If they are fed a different substance, for instance, grass-fed, they will have a different melting point for their lipid. So there's a lot of detail into this, but basically, when we're trying to cool things, we want to get to the point where fats begin to come out of solution and solidify. And when that happens, they will also grab other sources of fog and keep them with them. So turbulence is the third one, and we really don't want that. So it's sort of like T with a red line through it. So the fog specific gravity is lower than one. It's going to float. Suspended solids are going to sink. And so whenever we have a gravity grease interceptor, it won't look like a septic tank because the pipes that are going down inside the tank will go down deeper than in a standard septic tank. Standard septic tank, these outlet and inlet depths are approximately 40 to 50% of the tank depth. But in these, it'll be more like 6 inches off the bottom. So here's a graph of the of a side of a concrete septic grease interceptor. And you can see that the inlet, the ends of the inlet pipes are very close to the floor of the tank. And that's because basically we want the captured fog to sit in this level, and then just the water and whatever suspended solids would go into the next one, et cetera. Now, this one has risers on both ends of the tank. That's because if you were pumping this tank, you would pump some from this side, but then before too long, you'd come over to this side and do it, because if you were just take one side and pump it absolutely clean, the baffle would fall over. So you got to go from side to side to make sure you don't put any stress on that concrete. Concrete is very strong in compression, but this is actually tension in terms of standing up, and there's a force trying to tip it over in one way or the other. Also, this is a sample pit. This would be important, especially if you were going to central sewer, because what happens is that most urban cities and even some suburban places have, like, restaurants tend to glom together, and there's an area where there's a whole bunch of restaurants. If they're on sewer, they're going to, at some point, basically ruin the lift station, and they're going to have to replace it. And they want to make sure, well, who's doing that to us? Is it the restaurant A? Is it restaurant B? So they sample these on a recurring basis using their local authorities to do that. And they, when it's time to build a new, replace the pump in a lift station or build a new pump station, they basically tell people how much of that they owe by the data that they've collected in the intervening period. So it's very much being looked at. It's not being swept under the rug at all. So grease interceptors have to be located outside of the food preparation areas in a food service establishment. So we have sort of a distance to the building being a factor. If it's too close, the water that's going through the piping is too hot, and the emulsified fat, oils, and grease get through the interceptor, might get through two interceptors because it's so hot and it was put too close. But consequently, there's another problem, and that's shown with these diagrams here. If you give it too long of a length between the facility and the tank, the sewer line clogs before the discharge reaches the tank. And so what's happened in these cases is that it got cool enough that the animal fats began to solidify on the very inside edge of the pipe. And as more came through, it basically grabbed more vegetable oil, grabbed more fats, and started to clog it completely before it reached the tank. So that's a big problem. And the menu has an impact as well. So vegetable oils are somewhat water soluble. They'll only be retained if there is some animal fat there for them to coat. So what happens is, if you get animal fat solidifying, you'll actually do a good job on the vegetable oils as well, because they're both lipids. They are oleophilic, they attract to each other. So when we think about what we need to happen inside the gravity grease interceptor, we need to transfer heat. We need to basically cool the material. And so these are showing you how to heat something up, and in reverse, they would tell you how to cool something. So convection is basically shown inside the pan here above the campfire, and the fluid, liquid or gas, moving close to a hot surface, picks up the heat from that. A second way that heat is transferred is through conduction, through solid stationary fluids into a second material. So the person holding this pan is about to drop it because the conduction into the handle is going to be pretty hot in a moment. And then the third way that heat transfers is using electromagnetic waves. And it's very important in cooking food. It's very important in heat from the sun, et cetera, microwaves. So all three of these are in play in heating objects, and they're also in play in cooling objects as well. So at this point, I come to like an analogy. Imagine that it's lunchtime and you just got yourself a nice bowl of hot soup. And it is absolutely, looks delicious. It smells good. The heat is coming off of it. And you would like to eat this as much as possible. So which of the three heat transfer modes do you think would be the most effective for you to be able to eat that soup sooner? So what would you do? And I hope you're thinking this, but I'll tell you, what you do is you would blow on the top of that soup. And when you blow on the top of that soup, you're using convection. You're causing a cooler liquid, a cooler gas to move on top of the liquid, move on the heat. And so that's what we're going to use to cool a grease interceptor. So one of the things that I recommend with gravity grease interceptors is venting of air through that tank, basically in countercurrent method. So it would start near the end of the tank and move to the front of the tank, and then that heat can rise up in the pipe through the roof vent, and you can transfer heat this way. So that's something that isn't used an awful lot, but I found it to be very effective in what I wind up doing for my clients. So the density of air at atmospheric pressure is a function of temperature. And so you'll see that air at 90 degrees Fahrenheit is 0.72, but at 70 degrees, it's 0.75. So there is a substantial increase in density as it cools. And so you've seen the weather reports in your city, et cetera. What happens when a hot air mass collides with a cold air mass? Well, density rules out. And so the lighter material, the hotter material, rises up over that. And that's what causes rainfall, also causes wind as well. So we're using that density inside the grease interceptor because as it moves across the grease interceptor, it's going to have a natural tendency to rise up out of that pipe into the roof vent. So in designing grease interceptors, some of the things that come to be important are not normally thought about by folks in my field. So this is more of a plumbing engineering than it is a civil engineering type of exercise. So we have to think about the peak flow rate. The surface area is what's going to allow the contents of the grease interceptor to cool. We need to have a total storage volume that's adequate to keep the hot liquids in there for enough time to let them cool. And we can use baffles, filters, et cetera, to make sure that the hot liquid doesn't short circuit and just scoot across the tank and not get cooled down in the process. In a food service application, the kitchen flow has to be routed to the gravity grease interceptor before it is routed to the septic tank. So that is a major concern You can't keep them separate. You got to bring them together at some point if you are using a decentralized type of system. So location and service frequency is also something that we want to consider as well. A parking lot is a great place. A parking lot is going to have to be serviced sometime in the off hours for the facility. A loading dock might be a better location because traffic is not going to be parked over that. Under decks, if you have a hinged access so that you can lift it up, do the servicing, put it back down. And what you're shooting for is somewhere between 30 days and 90 days between services. If more frequent service is needed, that is telling you that the interceptor or number of interceptors are undersized. If you need to come out every 15 days and pump out a grease interceptor, you have a very, very small grease interceptor. If you can stand inside the tank on solid fat, and I have done that before on a dare, it's too long without service. But basically the contents of the tank are completely used up, and it's acting more like a 55-gallon grease interceptor because it's so stuffed full of fat, oils, and grease. It needs to be serviced regularly so that it does its job, you know, all the time. So there are ways to prevent short-circuiting, and these are, this is an idea from Leon Holt, who was with the Public Works Department in Cary, North Carolina, and he came out with this idea, and I agree with it 100%. If you can take the inlet flow and distribute it to either side of the tank, you basically can create what I call a double-barreled grease interceptor. Now, I would have brought the ends of these pipes much closer to the bottom, so that's something I don't agree with in there, and then also on this side as well. And then over here, rather than having a single exit, I think I would keep two commercial filters, and have them exit the wall through and keep this as double-barreled all the way through. So large multiple passes through the compartment wall. There's only two here, but they should be relatively large to make sure that it's not backing things up too bad. And then also use a distributed inlet to create multiple flow paths. So that is an idea. And one thing that I tell folks who are designing in their various states and provinces, the code that you're using hasn't changed in a very long time, but restaurants have. Restaurants are doing things a lot differently this decade than they did last decade, and the code just isn't keeping up with it. So when you are designing these grease interceptors, the code should be firmly in your rearview mirror. You don't want, oh, well, this meets code. Well, that's not very much comfort when the system backs up and the system is totally shot within a year. Okay, so the volume of all the interceptors is a key design decision, and we'll go through in detail how I recommend that you do it. I'm showing a air vent, that's the yellow, on this tank, and it's coming through and then moving through this tank, and then at this point it would go up into the roof vent. The first tank actually has got the Goldilocks factor. It's too hot, and the porridge is not going to be edible. It's going to go through there and cool down somewhat, but it's still going to be hot. This tank is the one that I hope is going to do the majority of the job. It has a commercial level filtration in two spots here and two spots here as well. So it's better to have a multiple easily cleanable interceptor in series than one gigantic interceptor. First of all, for a gigantic interceptor, you may have to bring a 5,000-gallon liquid vacuum truck out to the site, and those aren't easily easy to come by. if you had them, you could do, you know, first one tank, then the second tank, then the third tank. But really what I'm recommending is that you look at all tanks and pump the ones that need it. And the ones that don't need it, leave them alone for this trip, because you're going to be back out, you know, next month or in a month and a half. So the first interceptor is going to be too hot. It's not actually going to, you won't see much happening in here in terms of the fats coming out of suspension. The next interceptor should start to show fat solidifying in this tank. And this would be the one that you would pump just about every time. And then, you know, whenever somebody is really afraid of their pants dropping down, they'll wear a belt and suspenders. This third tank are my suspenders. So if for whatever reason there was a lot of usage and fats, oils, and grease made it to the third interceptor, this final interceptor allows remaining floating settling to occur and be pumped on an as-needed basis. So the way that I size grease interceptors has nothing to do with any state code. It's just using the state code, you wind up with a substantially smaller amount of grease interceptor than you actually need. So I'm using plumbing engineering tools to do this as well. And so what we have right now is the first table of, I think, three or four tables. So different equipment has different fixture unit equivalents. So a commercial dishwasher, I told you how those worked. There's something called a pot sink, which is extremely hot water that is used to clean individual pans and things of that nature. There's a cleanup sink and a mop sink, which is going to collect a lot of fats, oils, and grease as there are spills, et cetera. And a floor drain just by itself. So a floor drain, you know, if the fryer, you know, has a spill, it's going to the floor drain. And so that would also go to the grease interceptor. So each one of these has commercial dishwasher, pot sink, and cleanup mop sink all have three fixture unit equivalents. And the floor drain has two. I should also mention a three compartment sink that might be where we would put a hydrodynamic grease interceptor or an automatic grease interceptor. Those, the discharge from those would also come into the grease interceptor. So a three compartment sink is also worth two fixture units. Okay, so we add up for the facility all the different fixture units that they have in the kitchen area, and we add them up. And basically 1 to 6 fixture units, it produces a peak flow at the highest time in that facility of 30 gallons per minute. 7 to 9, 40 gallons per minute. 10 to 12 fixture units, 50 gallons per minute. And if you have greater than 12, you basically take the number of fixture units you have and multiply them by 4.1 gallons per minute. And that will give you the overall projected peak flow for the project. And what we have to do is we figure out what the design surface area is as a function of peak flow, because that surface area is where the cooling is going to occur. So if you have a peak flow rate of 30 gallons a minute, it's going to require 62 square feet of area in the tank that's going to be cooled to make this grease interceptor work. But if it was a much higher amount of flow, like 40 gallons per minute, 62 square feet wouldn't be enough. You'd have to go up to 82. With 50 gallons a minute of peak flow, you need 104. And with 60 gallons a minute of peak flow, you need 124 square foot. And as a comparison, a 3,000 gallon grease interceptor would have a required surface area of 129 square feet. So just as a FYI. So let's do a sample problem and figure out what would be an adequate amount of grease interceptors. So I have a 40-seat lunch and dinner sit-down restaurant. It has one dishwasher, one pot sink, one mop sink, and two floor drains. And so the question I want you to answer is, what size grease interceptors would you design for this facility using the procedure I just outlined for you? So the thing I want to point out, first of all, is that the idea of 40 gallons per seat times 40 seats, that has nothing to do with it. It's if that were the condition, then a sandwich restaurant where the meats were already pre-sliced and put behind a glass and they make the sandwich for you, that would have the same amount of fats, oils, and grease as a 40-seat pizzeria or a 40-seat Chinese restaurant or a 40-seat Mexican restaurant. And that's just not the case. The menu has a big impact on what happens here, and seats are not the thing to look at. So I solve it by saying there is 13 fixture units. So I'm already at the very bottom end of that first, that second table. And if I have more than 12 fixture units, I have 13 times 4.1. The answer becomes 53.3. And so we had a 50 and a 60. So we're going to go up to 60. This is a cherished tradition in engineering. And that's, you always round up. You never round down because you don't want the system to have a greater chance of not working. Basically, you give it some safety factor every time you round something up and an ability to accept a unusual circumstance. So if we use 60 gallons per minute for our design surface area, we wind up needing 124 square foot of surface area to cool the liquid in this grease interceptor. Well, a 3,000 gallon grease interceptor has a square foot of 129 square feet. So that's basically the length times the width. So what I would recommend in this situation is using 3 1,000 gallon tanks. It allows it to occur that way. That way they have cooling in each step of the process. And it's not something that you have to, pump out 3,000 gallons of grease interceptor waste in a single trip. Or if space was at a premium, I could live with two 1,500 gallon tanks in series. But I should point out that the Uniform Plumbing Code recommends for this kind of application, one 1,000 gallon tank. So it's basically one third of what I feel is needed to get a restaurant fats, oils, and grease to be intercepted, on a regular basis with a reasonable frequency in food service. So in the facility, we need to know the typical operating hours because that's where the peak flow is going to be generated. And if you think about it, there is 4 square feet in this restaurant that the owner knows more about than anywhere else in the restaurant. And that is the 4 square feet that surrounds the cash register. They know exactly what's going on there. So let's use that information. So the number of meals served gives another check on the sizing. So you can make sure how many meals do you serve? What's your heavy day? What's your light day, et cetera, et cetera. Those are going to be the peak hours that we need to know about. The self-serve salad bar is the number one source of fog, and that's basically overuse of dressing. And I'm as guilty of this as anybody is. If I'm at a restaurant and I order a salad, and I often do, the host or hostess will bring me a little cup of salad dressing. I will use that cup of salad dressing, and I will be a happy person. I'll have a very nice nice salad. If you put me at a self-serve salad bar, I will go through and my eyes will be bigger than my belly for a lot of stuff that's out there. And I'll load it up and then I will take a scoop and I'll scoop one scoop on. And I'll think, well, that's not quite enough. I have quite a bit of salad here. I'll take a second scoop. And basically that stuff is fat, oil, and grease. That's what that is. And so we got to make sure there's good plate scraping to make sure that that doesn't wind up in the dishwasher. We want to get it off before it goes to the dishwasher. We also can use disposable paper. And if you do that, that's the number one improvement in the effluent in a high strength waste food service establishment. Some additional facility tips. In the field that I'm in, the on-site wastewater field, I feel like we always basically tell people what they've lost by going with an on-site system. You know, well, now you can't do this, now you can't do that. And I'd rather rephrase the question to say, well, sure, you can have a deep fat fryer in this restaurant, but it's going to cost this much more in terms of the size of the grease interceptors that we have. And is it making enough money to be worth this cost? And if it is, definitely we'll put it in. I have no problem making the system optimal for that particular customer. If it's self-serve ice cream too, ice cream drippings are very high in BOD. It really accelerates the growth in microbes. They get really happy. And so these are things to be concerned about with what you're doing inside your food service establishment. The ice machine can send gallons of water to the system unnecessarily. Make sure it's not leaking. And if you want to put it somewhere that's not sewage, you could put it in its own separate location if you wanted to. So in the field, there are methods that you can use to troubleshoot the effluent characteristics at a particular food service establishment. So basically what I do is I go to the grease interceptor and I have a gauntleted hand, not just a gloved hand, but a gauntleted hand. In other words, it comes up my arm almost to my elbow and I stick it at the exit of that grease interceptor. And if I can't hold my hand in there because it's so hot, it's short circuiting. Or it's too small and it has good flow, but it's just not enough of it there. So solution that I might recommend in that case, chemical rinse, go to a distributed inlet, commercial grade filters, two in parallel, add more tanks if you possibly can. Sometimes the person who is selling you these chemicals will decide that you're not using enough of them. And so a good check of this material is to check with a pH meter. If it's under 4, that is low. Somebody has turned up the amount of rinse that is going into the dishwasher, and it's, you know, making it very hard for whatever is coming after it, be it a sewage treatment plant or a septic tank, to deal with it because it's basically on the verge of being a hazardous waste. So some final tips and tricks. So if you have excessive fog, even at 100 degrees Fahrenheit temperature, you can change the menu from vegetable oil to vegetable shortening. And this would be very helpful because that the vegetable shortening will solidify at a higher temperature. And then the vegetable oils, canola, olive oil, et cetera, that are very low melting points, they will coat that, stay in liquid form, but they will be kept in that situation. Have had to deal with vegan restaurants and vegetarian restaurants. And of course, they don't have any fats, et cetera. So what I do is I have my service people basically have filters from a variety of different establishments. And they basically don't try to clean them right there. They bag them, they take them back to the office, and they clean them at their leisure because they really want to get a lot of stuff off of it. But even after you clean a filter, it still has a residual on them. And so what worked for these vegetarian and vegan restaurants is they take the effluent filter from a rib joint or a barbecue joint, and they put it in the receptacle for the vegetarian restaurant, and it coats. It starts grabbing the vegetable oils right then. Don't tell anybody I said that. I'll have to deny it. And then the final tip is service all your tanks just before Mother's Day, because that's the day when everybody says, let's give mom a break from cooking. We'll all go out to eat. And so those tanks better be ready for what they're about to do to them. So I think with that, that's my last slide. I will now look into the chats and hand it, stop sharing, bring it back to you, Armor, and you can we can look at some of these chat questions.
Thank you, Dr. Sherman. Great presentation. I think the material was pretty clear.
Good.
Thank you, everyone.
If anybody wasn't able to write down the tables, that was a lot of information right there. The recorded seminar will be available, and they can download it at their leisure and make sure that they understand the various topics.
That is true. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. And as Dr. Sherman said, it will be recorded and posted at a later date. You can also watch our last year 2021 webinar series and our upcoming events as well. And the links are in the chat box. Our next webinar event will be hosted on Thursday, March 17th. Mr. Bob Ribori, president of Biomicrobics, will present the successes and challenges of decentralized wastewater in developing world. Thank you again, and we look forward to see you in our next session. And bye for now.
Take care, everybody. Take care.